inspiring. There are people to thank and introductions to be made, so I'm going to try and be quick here. First, I'd like to thank the Contemporary Jewish Museum in San Francisco and Donald Albrecht, the exhibit curator, who originally produced the exhibit Designing Home in 2004 in San Francisco. A big thanks to everyone at Parsons, the New School, and Cooper Hewitt, Smithsonian Design Museum, especially Sarah A. Lichtman, and Marilyn Cohen, my design guides and co-producers for today's event. And to this morning's speakers, of course, Jenna Weissman Joselit, Alice T. Friedman, and Ruth Adler Schnee. The Beverly Willis Architecture Foundation graciously provided the excerpt you'll see of Radiant Sun, and this and all of the museum's public programs are the result of a generous gift of Mrs. Lily J. Safra. Now on to the introduction. Sarah A. Lichtman is an assistant professor of design history at the director of the master's program in the history of design and curatorial studies offered jointly by Parsons the New School and Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum. She received her MA and PhD from the Bard Graduate Center. Her articles and reviews have appeared in the Journal of Design History, Studies in the Decorative Arts, Design and Culture, and West 86. I'm very excited about this part. In 2015, Lichtman was awarded the Distinguished Teaching Award by the New School. Please welcome Sarah.
Thank you, Alice. And thank you to the staff of the Museum of Jewish Heritage for hosting us here today for this morning's symposium on Jewish culture and modern design. This is the first collaboration that Parsons, the New School, and the Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum has had with the Museum of Jewish Heritage, and I hope it's one of many to continue in the future. I also want to thank Parsons, the Cooper Hewitt Master's Program, and of course all of our speakers, and particularly Ruth Adler Schnee, who traveled from Michigan to be with us this morning. The theme for today's symposium comes from the exhibition Designing Home, Jews and Mid-Century Modernism, curated by Donald Albrecht, who is also a faculty member in the Parsons Cooper Hewitt MA program, and this is how this idea of the collaboration really came about. The exhibition looks at the ways in which Jewish architects and designers contributed to a domestic and American modern aesthetic in the post-war period. In the aftermath of World War II, when the locus of world Jewry shifted to the United States from Europe, American Jews enjoyed a newfound mainstream acceptance. Eugene J. Lippmann and Albert Vorspan, leaders of Reform Judaism, described mid-century Jews as, quote, jet-propelled from the periphery of American life to a rising middle-class status. For some, both recent immigrants and those native-born, modern design and architecture in particular offered, according to Donald Albrecht, unprecedented opportunities for and acceptance of Jews. Several notable cultural institutions across the United States helped facilitate entry into careers in architecture and design and provide the framework for the exhibition Designing Home. These included cultural institutions such as the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis and the Museum of Modern Art in New York, and educational organizations such as Pond Farm in Guerneville, California, and Black Mountain College in Asheville, North Carolina. For many Jewish designers, the attitude of Victor S. Reese, an emigre metalsmith and teacher at Pond Farm, typified the often removed feelings some felt about being Jewish and the virulent anti-Semitism of Europe they had fled. Reese explained, quote, "We did not talk about it," meaning the war. "We did not talk about it. What for? We were not Jews at Pond Farm. We were artists." This is not to say that Jewish designers, assimilated or not, didn't face anti-Semitism here in the United States. In a 1938 letter to Walter Gropius, the founding director of the German Bauhaus, MoMA director Alfred H. Barr expressed concern that some visitors to the museum's Bauhaus exhibition perceived it as, quote, too Jewish. According to Barr, some associated the foreign-sounding names with Jewish communists. One solution, Barr wrote, was to state clearly that really not as many Jews were at the Bauhaus as one might think. Barr wrote, and this is a quote, although the Bauhaus welcomed Jewish students, there were no Jews on its faculty. Now, whether this is true or not, Walter Gropius, much to his credit, wanted no part of such qualifications, and no texts were amended in the exhibition to explain that there weren't as many Jews as the Bauhaus as people had worried about. However, Barr's statement and Gropius's response really set the tone for the often contradictory attitude faced by Jewish designers and architects in the mid-20th century. And what I'd like to do now is, I don't want to go on too long with my remarks so we can get the morning session going. I'd like to introduce my co-collaborator, Marilyn Cohen, who will come up here to speak to us about how the morning session will unfold, the list of events and speakers, and how we hope that these papers and conversations here today will help explore and amplify some of the many issues addressed in the exhibition and also in the terrific catalog that accompanies the exhibition as well. Marilyn Cohen has her doctorate in art history from the Institute of Fine Arts, New York University, and an MA from the Bard Graduate Center. She currently teaches in the MA program for the History of Design and Curatorial Studies, offered jointly by Parsons the New School and the Cooper Hewitt, as well as in the Parsons Fashion Studies MA program. Marilyn lectures and publishes in the field of popular and material culture. She was the curator for the exhibition Reginald Marsh's New York, and author of its catalog. Her most recent essay, Wall Streets, is slated to appear in the upcoming Routledge Companion to Design Studies. Welcome, Marilyn.
Thank you, Sarah, Alice, and all of you for being here this morning, the day after Shavuos, a celebration of spring, and the season perhaps most related in its optimistic spirit to the exhibition Designing Home that we're discussing today. I'd like to lay out this morning's program for you. That's my job. To begin with, we'll be hearing two talks, one by Jenna Weissman Joselit, entitled Jewish Geometry, American Jews and Modernism, which will focus on synagogues in the post-war era. And the other by Alice Friedman, entitled American Glamour, which will look primarily at the post-war design of homes or mid-century modernism in relation to architects, clients, and photographers, such as Morris Lapidus, Richard Neutra, and Julius Schulman, who shaped a new idea of glamour. After Alice's talk, we will take a 15-minute recess to stretch our legs, whether they're long or short ones, and we will then reconvene to view an abridged version of a documentary on the life of the iconic and pioneer textile designer Ruth Adler Schnee, entitled The Radiant Sun, Designer Ruth Adler Schnee. After the film, we are greatly honored to present Ruth Adler Schnee herself in conversation with Sarah Lichtman. Following their conversation, we'll have a short Q&A period. So please do jot down any questions you might have related to Jenna or Alice's talk, as well as about Ruth's conversation with Sarah. As Sarah just said, the aim of this symposium is to enrich the exhibition upstairs, which is a truly beautiful and varied presentation of the work of Jewish designers in the mid-century, ranging from furniture by George Nelson to Saul Bass's film credits for such movies as Exodus, and of course, textile designs by Ruth Adler Schnee, among many, many other things. Before beginning, I'd also like to point out, as Sarah mentioned, that the catalog for the exhibit includes essays, one by Jenna Weissman Joselit herself, garnered from other books on Jewish American cultural studies that provide a background or context for the exhibition, which Donald Albrecht, who you know is the curator for the original exhibition at the Contemporary Jewish Museum in San Francisco, explained to me the other day, are meant to more fully explore the place of Jews, design, and the nature of home in 20th century America. And while the exhibition is entitled Designing Home, Jews and Mid-Century Modernism, It's not about designing a specifically Jewish home in America through using ritual objects, for example, although you will find some ritual objects, I think, in the exhibit upstairs. But rather, it's about how Jewish designers, whether born in America or not, helped to design the mid-century and avant-garde American home. An emphasis is here on American. Donald concluded from his research for the exhibition that the design world in the mid-century was in fact extremely inclusive of the work of Jews because their designs were valued as excellent products of modernity. Donald described the American design culture through its institutions, some of which Sarah just named, include MoMA or the Case House Study in California or the Walker Art Center, as, quote, aesthetic Ellis Islands, end quote, for Jewish architects and designers, I love that expression, ways for them to enter into a new kind of aesthetic or avant-garde spirit that was considered American. Our talks today will perhaps navigate the distinctions between what constitute the American or Jewish component of mid-century experience. In Jenner's catalog essay, she quoted Paul Romanoff, the New York Jewish Museum's curator, who in 1933 wrote that a visit to the museum, quote, is bound to strengthen the tie of the individual Jew to his people and to strengthen his pride in his race, end quote. The objects on display in the Jewish Museum, wrote Romanoff, quote, bring the past to life, enlighten the present, and lend glamour to the wholesome, patriarchal life of the Jews, end quote. And one might reasonably ask whether this exhibit does the same, but perhaps that's a question best left to the end of this program. It's now my great pleasure to introduce Jenna Weissman Joselit. Jenna Weissman Joselit is the Charles E. Smith Professor of Judaic Studies and Professor of History at the George Washington University, where she also created and now directs two graduate programs in Jewish culture and the arts, the first of their kind in the country. She's the author of, among other things, The Wonders of America, which received the National Jewish Book Award in History, and of the critically acclaimed A Perfect Fit, Clothes, Character, and the Promise of America. She writes a monthly column for the Forward, now in its 15th consecutive year of publication, and is also a frequent contributor to the New Republic and Tablet. She also blogs at www.fromunderthefigtree.com. In addition to teaching and writing, Jenna has enjoyed an active career as a museum curator and consultant. Her most recent exhibition, Shalom Bais, Reflections on the American Jewish Home, is on view at the Yiddish Book Center in Amherst. A former senior fellow at Princeton's Center for the Study of American Religion, on whose academic advisory board she currently sits, she's also been a fellow at Michigan's Frankel Institute, Penn's Center for Advanced Judaic Studies, and Yale's Center for American Art and Material Culture. And most recently, Weissman Joselit has been a distinguished visiting scholar at the Library of Congress's John W. Kluge Center, where she's worked on her current book project, A Study of America's Relationship to the Ten Commandments. Jenna, please come up here. We're looking forward to hearing your talk.
May I have the first slide, please? Somebody? No, those are Ruth's. Wrong PowerPoint. Okay. We need those visuals. Here we go. Thank you. When I was growing up in a Long Island suburb, on a lovely, leafy street called Margaret Avenue, my home was filled with dishes, dairy dishes, meat dishes, and a full complement of Passover dishes. The conditions of their use were dictated not just by the rituals of Kashrut, the Jewish dietary laws, or by the demands of the calendar. The use of these implements was also determined by an internal kitchen taxonomy, which neatly divided them into two categories: the everyday dishes, which were sturdy, reliable, and a bit ho-hum, and the good dishes, a more rarefied set of plates and bowls and teacups, whose designation as good seemed to be both a matter of virtue and expense. My mother, a daughter of immigrants who came of age in post-war America, had a special fondness for her good dairy dishes. A set of American modern earthenware produced by Russell Wright in what the New York Times called an intriguingly drab shade of mustard. My mother preferred these dishes to all the other dishes in her domestic kingdom. I've always wondered why. Did her preference for them have to do with their heft, the way they felt in her hands as she set the table or carefully placed them in the newfangled dishwasher? Maybe she just liked the way they looked, smooth like pebbles, unfussy, clean. Then again, perhaps the Russell Wright dishes spoke to her of independence. After all, the other dishes on her shelves were either wedding gifts, a reflection of someone else's taste, or hand-me-downs, an accumulation of stuff rather than its purposeful acquisition. The Russell Wright dishes were something else again. She had purchased them all by herself. Had I put the matter to my mother, she might have said that her affection for American modern earthenware was an entirely personal bit of business, a measure of her sensibility rather than an artifact of history or a sociological truism. But in this, she would have been mistaken. Everything, memoir, advertisements, oral histories, and exhibitions like Designing Home, everything makes clear that Russell Wright dishes were not only found at 45 Margaret Avenue. They also thickened the shelves of thousands of suburban Jewish homes just like mine. American Modern had a Jewish address. Don't get me wrong, it's not that modernism was a Jewish phenomenon. It wasn't. Rather, modernism was a phenomenon that appealed mightily to the Jews. There's a big difference between the two, and it's within the spaces of that difference that I situate my talk this morning. The Jewish affinity for modernism, and more broadly still, the Jewish embrace of modernity, is a fascinating story rooted in European Jewish history. Memoirs, novels, scholarly monographs, hot off the press news items about the cultural repatriation of looted art, as well as recently unearthed inventories of household goods confiscated by the Nazis. All this bears witness to the ways in which European Jews took to modernity with gusto. It's not hard to see why. Modernity was kind to the Jews, at least at first. Under its sheltering wing, they were quite literally emancipated. For the very first time in history, European Jews were extended the franchise, a franchise that was as much economic, cultural, and psychological as it was political. For the first time in history, European Jews felt they belonged. Little wonder, then, that they made much of the newfound circumstances in which they found themselves, seizing opportunities in the marketplace of ideas and goods to shake things up, to rethink, to fashion an expanded sense of self. And yet, even as they pursued new ideas and even newer forms of identity, European Jews modernized as a group, together. For the Jews, then, modernization was not just an exercise in self-affirmation. Modernization was a vehicle of communal affiliation as well. Perhaps the clearest, certainly the most tangible proof of the Jews' affinity for modernity, could be found at home, whose newly acquired sideboards, chandeliers, and objets d'art reflected a common sensibility, or what historian Leora Auslander calls a shared and distinctive taste system, one that inclined the Jews to clearly discernible patterns of design informed actively by modernism. In Berlin and in Paris and Prague and in Warsaw, Jewish consumer preferences, she points out, were shaped by the geography of consumption, by the range of available goods, by the network of stores in which the Jews shopped, by the web of advertisements, go back a bit, the web of advertisements they encountered in the Jewish press, by what they saw in a relative's home. Nourished as much by community as by the marketplace, These consumer preferences were also fortified by their Jewishness, by a constellation of gestures, behaviors, and sensibilities that grew directly out of the ways in which the Jews as a group historically experienced time and space, smell, and sensation. Jewishness, Auslander explains, was deeply relevant to modern Jewry's collective affection for modernism. The notion of a Jewish taste system holds just as true for American Jews as for their European cousins. Although the consumer practices of post-war American Jews are not nearly as widely studied as those associated with the Old World, the consumer practices of post-war American Jews, the color palette they fancied, their use of space, the number of books on their shelves, much less the number of bookshelves in their homes, their preference for a highboy in which to display their dishes rather than a garage in which to store their tools. These distinctive earmarks of a middle-class American Jewish home were similarly shaped by a confluence of internal and external forces, by the newspapers they read, the neighborhood stores they patronized, the home decorating manuals they consulted, by the advice of their friends, and their experiences above all else as the children of immigrants. For post-war American Jews, style, especially modernist style, was as much a collective phenomenon as an individual one. And yet, what renders American Jewry's relationship to modernism most striking, even emblematic, is its public face. Where European Jews most commonly express their fidelity to modernism within the four L's of their homes, American Jews most vividly express theirs in public, in the construction of post-war synagogues. Time and again, American suburban synagogues of the 1950s and 60s elected to go modern, a decision ratified and even spearheaded by the Union of American Hebrew Congregations and by the United Synagogue, the congregational arm of the Reform and Conservative denominations, respectively. Maintaining a standing set of committees to dispense advice on matters architectural and aesthetic, these two Jewish organizations advise their constituents to eschew the classical and the Georgian, the Byzantine and the Moorish, those traditional idioms of the American synagogue, in favor of a resolutely modern building with abundant natural light, a modicum of ornamentation, and a lot of flexible seating, or as the lingo then had it, a system of interpenetrating functions. Post-war rabbis, confronted with the multiple challenges of erecting a synagogue from scratch and in places where Jewish houses of worship were scarce, rabbis became as conversant and as current with modernism as their congregants. They consulted one another, traded experiences at rabbinical conferences, and made sure to familiarize themselves with the oh-so-helpful advice proffered by Peter Blake in his book, An American Synagogue for Today and Tomorrow, a 311-page compendium of information on air conditioning, lighting, acoustics, and the spatial elements of contemporary design. Inspired by the possibilities, some rabbis, such as Mortimer Cohn of Philadelphia's Beit Shalom congregation, went beyond reading, even going so far as to commission Frank Lloyd Wright to design a new synagogue in suburban Philadelphia. The relationship between the clergyman and the architect wasn't without its sparks of creative tension. Frank Lloyd Wright had his ideas. Rabbi Cohn had his. In the end, what resulted was a soaring pyramid of light whose unadorned sanctuary had more in common with a posh concert hall than with a traditional house of worship. Symbolically enough, at its center reposed not a traditional bima, as Rabbi Cohn had requested, but an imposing light fixture made of translucent glass and aluminum. Frank Lloyd Wright had insisted on it. Beit Shalom wasn't the only synagogue whose features celebrated the technological and spatial properties of modernism, often at the expense of tradition. Far from it. Virtually every post-war suburban synagogue from coast to coast and in between assumed a decidedly modernist cast. North Shore Congregation in Glencoe, Illinois, Chizuk Emunah in Baltimore, Bethel in Providence, Rhode Island, Temple Sinai in Los Angeles, Temple Mount Sinai in El Paso. The number of horizontal, low-strung, unornamented concrete synagogues takes your breath away. Somewhere along the line, the pursuit of modernism had become an American Jewish communal imperative, a physical expression of the common weal. Describing American Jewry's embrace of modernism is one thing, accounting for it quite another. How are we to explain the presence of Russell Wright dishes in suburban Jewish homes and the ubiquity of streamlined synagogues? Was it an accident of timing, a matter of cost perhaps? Just one of those things. You have to wonder. Even as early as 1954, when the modernist synagogue was in full blossom, a number of clear-eyed observers, among them the art critic Leo Steinberg, sought to make sense of this development. Suppose, said Steinberg, suppose some art historian in remote future times lights on the synagogue lately built by Percival Goodman for the Temple Bethel Congregation of Providence, Rhode Island. Suppose further, that little of our present architecture has come down to him. And lastly, that the vocabulary of criticism in that distant day has gained nothing over time in semantic rigor, but remains, as now, unfettered, vague, and metaphorical. What would that future historian have to say? How would he account for modernism's grip on the American Jewish imagination? Well, she would say that for the Jews, the allure of modernism transcended its good looks. For the Jews, modernism was a visual proclamation of possibility. Banishing the past, which hung heavy, modernism put a premium on the future. In the face of its promise to unencumber, to set free, to try new things and new materials, the Jews found it awfully hard to resist. More to the point, modernism, as one of its champions put it, was most expressive of America, of its spirit of adaptation, its embrace of novelty. What better way, then, for the Jews of the 1950s to make themselves at home in America to feel one with the nation than by laying claim to this most resolutely American of sensibilities, whose goal, as Steinberg himself lyrically explained, whose goal was to make men and women breathe more freely. Just suppose. Thank you.
Jenna. Thank you so much. I love that modernism as a visual proclamation of possibility. I am now very pleased to introduce our second speaker this morning, Alice T. Friedman. Alice Friedman is the Grace Slack McNeil Professor of American Art at Wellesley College, where she's taught since 1979. Professor Friedman is the author of numerous books and articles on gender, sexuality, and the social history of architecture, including House and Household in Elizabethan England, Wallaton Hall, and the Willoughby Family, Women in the Making of the Modern House, a Social and Architectural History, and American Glamour and the Evolution of Modern Architecture. Her current projects include a study of Richard Lippold's sculpture and installations, and a special issue of Interiors, Design, Architecture, Culture on Spaces of Faith, which she's co-editing with Professor Anne Massey of Middlesex University. And now, it's my pleasure to introduce Alice T. Friedman.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to say how pleased I am to be here. And I want to thank the museum for inviting me. I'm thrilled to be on the program with us. Some scholars whose work I've long admired, particularly Professor Joselit, whose work helped me enormously in my own. And we all owe her a huge debt, and thank you for that beautiful lecture. In American Glamour and the Evolution of Modern Architecture, a book that I published in 2010, I tried to identify the qualities of design that make mid-century modern architecture, best known for buildings like Eero Saarinen's TWA building at Kennedy Airport, Richard Neutra's Kaufman Desert House, which is in the exhibition, Morris Lapidus's... Sorry, how's that? It's always a challenge. Neutra's Kaufman Desert House, which is in the exhibition, Lapidus's Miami Beach Hotels, like the Algiers, shown here, or the Fontainebleau, or the Eden Rock, or Frank Lloyd Wright's Beth Shalom Temple in Elkins Park that we just heard about. Mid-century modern was a distinctive style created in post-war America and shaped by the tastes and talents of a particular historical time, place, and culture. These buildings, together with their distinctive furnishings, lighting, and imagery, were created by architects who sought not only to respond to the functional and aesthetic demands of their clients, but who also grappled with modernist precedents that had been established in Europe a generation earlier by figures such as Walter Gropius, Mies van der Rohe, and Le Corbusier. In these endeavors to shape a new modernism, they were closely watched not only by their professional colleagues, but also by American business leaders, American consumers, and by an outspoken, opinionated, younger generation of American men and women, many of whom were newly married and independent from their immigrant parents, as we heard, well-off, well-educated, and newly arrived in the booming suburbs that ringed American cities. Many of them were Jewish. Of course, tastes varied widely in the 1950s, from the elegantly modern Seagram building on Park Avenue to the lavishly ornamented hotels of Miami Beach. But for the first time in history, architecture had become a spectator sport, popularized through magazines and television, studied by a wide range of observers, and commented on by building committees, as we heard, some of which included women, who had never had the opportunity to express opinions on such matters before. Making modern architecture was now not just a matter of perfecting historical styles learned in the ivory towers of the East Coast universities or in European academies, but a self-described living response to the multiple challenges of the new industrial era of rising standards of living, the growth of cities, and the rapid communication methods of the time. It was a popular and populist style for a new century, and post-war America provided an exciting new testing ground for all of its myriad ideas. What links these disparate examples of post-war modernism, it seems to me, is the idea that architecture, like other consumer products, should have a certain glamour, an elastic but durable concept that had become newly current in the 20s, 30s, and 40s when these clients were growing up. The desire for glamour and the ability to recognize it, paired with a high priority placed on individual narratives of progress and success, had far-reaching implications for mid-century modern American architecture, not only because there were significant values in post-war America, as we heard, but also, I would argue, because these were the values that lay at the very core of the modern experience. The term glamour, which had its roots in the Scottish word for magic and occult learning, had been used at least since the mid-19th century, although it was not until the advent of industrial urban society in the 1920s and 30s that it became widespread. Dictionary definitions vary widely and almost always require multiple headings to encompass its various meanings. But all of them emphasize the artificial construction of an image through adornments like clothing, cosmetics, or jewelry, and through theatrical staging and lighting, or distinctive physical movements. Moreover, definitions of glamour usually include some reference to the magical or dreamlike effects these devices had on observers. For example, as we see here, through the visual and mental association of a woman in an evening gown, a new model Oldsmobile, and a fast-moving jet streaking across the night sky, all in the bright technicolor of the time, of course. Glamour was not just a look, but as we would say today, a lifestyle. This is surely the way in which readers of Glamour magazine, which began publication as Glamour of Hollywood in 1939 and changed its name 2 years later, and many other publications of the time, used the word in the mid-20th century. But the matter remained complex. The first issue of the magazine goes to some lengths to provide a definition, using a series of celebrity interviews, articles, advertisements, and glossy glamour photos of movie stars to circle around its multiple meanings. Here, as elsewhere, the prevailing definitions referred to image making, dominated by associations with Hollywood and with the magical ability of objects, and we should emphasize of buildings and interiors as well, to enhance an individual's power, sexual attractiveness, or allure. Most significant for all of Glamour magazine's purposes, and for our own as we attempt to come to terms with this cluster of concepts and cultural values, was the promise that even ordinary individuals could acquire some of this power for themselves through consumption, guided by the images and products contained in films, and magazines, and through the construction of elaborate dream worlds filled with desirable objects and experiences. Glamour magazine made this democratic and egalitarian message very clear. Looking at a photo of Richard Neutra's Kaufman Desert House in Palm Springs, California, designed in 1946 for the Pittsburgh department store owner Edgar J. Kaufman and his wife Lillian, who a decade earlier had built Frank Lloyd Wright's Falling Water, It isn't hard to recognize the elements of illusion, enchantment, and glamour that make the image of the house so powerful. The choice of site with the mountains behind, the effects of lighting, the addition of elements like the elegantly spare swimming pool, and the glass curtain wall all contribute to the magical effect. Clearly, these distinctive qualities are the result of collaborative efforts of staging, image making, and choreography for both interior and exterior. They required the participation of an architect, lighting designer, interior specialists, including the Kaufmans themselves, who knew very well the business of merchandising and the allure of new technologies, and of course, the photographer, who created the glamorous image. How would Neutra's Kaufman Desert House look to our eyes, and perhaps more important, appear in our memories and imaginations without the intervention of lighting designer Richard Kelly, one of the only non-Jewish participants in this project, and the photographer Julia Shulman? How do the contributions of these artists, together with the work of interior designers, muralists, furniture designers, sculptors, many of whom had carefully studied the methods of Hollywood producers and advertising specialists, enhance the work of architecture? As depicted in Shulman's famous photograph, the Kaufman House appears as an abstract composition of planes, volumes, and lines, all brought to life by a vivid lighting scheme in which the soffit planes, interior volumes, and the deep water of the swimming pool, to name only the most obvious elements, all shine brightly against the dark background of lawn, trees, and backlighted mountains. As some of you know already, Shulman's photograph was not only the result of careful staging, and we should note here the figure of Lillian Kaufman reclining by the pool in a position chosen specifically to block the glare of the underwater pool light, but also a product of extensive work in the darkroom and of Shulman's decision to turn on every light of the house at once for his photo so that the theatrical and spectacular character of the house in its context could be brought to life more successfully. As Life magazine put it in 1949, Shulman's photograph glamorized Neutra's modern architecture, yet it is equally clear that just as much or even more of the credit is owed to the lighting scheme, which was the work of the great lighting designer Richard Kelly, without whom not only Neutra, but many other modern architects, including Saarinen, Kahn, and Philip Johnson, would have been left in the dark, both literally and figuratively. When we look at a photograph like Julia Shulman's Case Study 22, an image that is probably familiar to many of you, it's easy to see why the architecture and design of the period had such a powerful appeal. The picture shows two fashionably clad women sitting in the living room of Pierre Koenig's Stahl House, built in 1960, an elegant composition of steel and glass that seems to float like a brightly lighted beacon above the Southern California night. The house was one of a number built under the aegis of the so-called Case Study House program, sponsored by Arts and Architecture magazine from 1945 on. These modern homes were intended to demonstrate that high-quality modern architecture and popular appeal could coexist in post-war America. As depicted by Julia Shulman, the house's spare lines are highlighted by contrasts of light and shadow that have been orchestrated for dramatic effect. They created a bold frame for the objects inside the house, the women's bodies in full skirts, the globe lamps suspended from above, the low coffee table on which a cigarette box and a pair of binoculars have been carefully placed. And they also draw our attention to the twinkling trajectories of light etched out against the black background that stretched toward the horizon. This was a new world depicted by Shulman. There's a modern looking lounge chair. Let's see if this works. Oh, there we go. In the immediate foreground of the photograph, suggesting the presence of a patio and a swimming pool. Overall, the photograph exudes the feeling of comfortable indoor-outdoor living that lay at the core of the American dream. It speaks of leisure, accessibility, wide open spaces, and car culture. Because we watch the women who face each other as if absorbed in a conversation and unaware of our presence from outside the glass wall, we feel we are observing a private moment illicitly. All of these elements, the night scene, the cinematic quality of the lighting and the frame, the intimate engagement of the female figures in the interior, our position as covert observers, enhance our curiosity and pleasure. Indeed, they blur the boundaries between architecture, film, fashion, and photography, making the modern house seem more like a fantasy stage set and less like an object, a stage set on which the women enact a beautiful fantasy of modern living. Shulman's photograph thus offers us an alluring image of a new kind of American glamour rooted in modern architectural space and material reality. Remember that for consumers, even the purchase of a lipstick or a hat or a dish would bring you to this world. In so doing, it suggests a distinctive experience of modernity and of freedom. This is exactly the sort of glamour that the architect and interior specialist Morris Lapidus captured so effectively in his store designs and shop fronts, primarily in New York City and in his hotels, most of which were located in Miami Beach, though some of you know his Summit Hotel on Lexington Avenue, which is now the DoubleTree. In this 1948 image, taken by the masterful photographer, very not so well-known photographer, Samuel Herman Gacho, whose entire archive is in the Library of Congress. The Dodge Showroom at 175th Street and Broadway. There's a combination of interior lighting, signage, and a curving marquee that creates the image of Hollywood glamour, conferring the status of a beautiful starlet on a late model car. Thus, the showroom is conceived in the manner of a cinema, its bright lights illuminating the dark sky like the Klieg lights at a movie premiere. Born in Odessa in 1902, Morris Lapid is shown here with his beloved wife, Beatrice, had a degree in architecture from Columbia University, but as he described in his autobiography, aptly entitled, Too Much Is Never Enough. His first and lasting loves were Coney Island and theatrical stage design. Both of these passions served him well when he embarked on a successful career in retail design and from the late 40s on in hotel architecture. Lapidus's earliest Miami Beach hotels, all designed in collaboration with more experienced architects, included the Sans Souci here, which you see here of 1949 with Roy France, the Biltmore Terrace Hotel in North Miami Beach in 1951 with Albert Annis, and the Algiers, which we saw earlier, a large complex on Collins Avenue, built by the Levitson family, proprietors of Tamarack Lodge in the Catskills, designed by Henry Hohauser and Melvin Grossman. Thanks to a strong local economy and to the popularity of Miami Beach as a vacation destination after the war, Jewish hotel developers and their mostly Jewish architects had been extending their reach and increasing the scale and budgets of their buildings incrementally for the past two decades. Among the first in a long line of these projects was the Grossinger's Pancoast, another hotel with a Catskill pedigree, which took over the previously restricted Pancoast Hotel in 1945 and featured a kosher kitchen. It would eventually be demolished to make way for the newly built Seville Hotel by Melvin Grossman, an enormous complex with a pool deck, shops, and multiple restaurants located just north of that Algiers Hotel by Lapidus. These gargantuan creations marched steadily northward along Collins Avenue, creating a wall of high-rise structures that dominated the oceanfront like beached ocean liners. This trend picked up speed in the 1950s as developers purchased vacant lots and demolished existing real estate to create vast land parcels, mowing down the abandoned estates of the super rich A-list Gentile socialists of the 1920s. Okay, mowing down. it was the Jewish socialists that they were worried about, not the A-list Gentiles. Mowing down the abandoned estates of the super rich A-list Gentile socialites of the 1920s and replacing them with new hotels that catered to a diverse group of post-war consumers, including newly wealthy suburban vacationers from Northeast and Midwestern cities, many of them first and second generation Jewish Americans, for whom the experience and the image of luxury and the fantasy of a glamorous tropical vacation were especially appealing. At Morris Lapidus's Fontainebleau Hotel, here, which you see under construction, looming menacingly above the old Mediterranean Revival Firestone estate, the much feared by some displacement of the Gentile social order by a new generation of Jewish Miami Beach vacationers was vividly staged. It is no wonder that the new hotels and the distinctive style and panache of the newcomers immediately captured the imagination of both tourists and the press, who wrote about them with barely concealed envy and more than a hint of anti-Semitism. In 1954, the Fontainebleau represented a completely different order of magnitude in hotel architecture. Nothing in the history of hotel design in Miami Beach or elsewhere adequately prepared the public or the critics for the monumental scale and modern appearance of the Fontainebleau with its extensive Renaissance-style gardens, which you can't see here, its air conditioning and beach cabanas, its unprecedented extension of hotel services and amenities provided all under one roof, all of which went well beyond the provision of guest rooms and featured expansive lobbies, dramatic staircases, card and game rooms, multiple restaurants like the elegant Fleur-de-Lis, snack bars, nightclubs, indoor and outdoor swimming pools, vast pool decks. There we go. So there's the gardens in a later iteration without the Renaissance style ones. But you can see the cabanas, the tennis courts, observation platforms, and ample parking for the huge tail finned Chevys and Cadillacs that and Oldsmobiles like my grandparents arrived in. Here, Lapidus cleverly seized on both the typology and glamour of the great ocean liners, one of the era's most immediate, recognizable, and broadly appealing symbols, with its connotations of elegance, speed, and excitement, to create a new kind of image, making it clear that his post-war hotels were new and modern and updated, but unmistakably connected to jazz age traditions of popular entertainment and tropical luxury. The bold image of the ocean liner, familiar to consumers from tablet posters, movies, and a wide range of fashionable products, represented not only glamorous travel and the spirit of discovery in faraway places, and also that movement and liberation that we were talking about, but also the most up-to-date engineering and technology, modern conveniences. These were precisely the themes that Miami Beach's post-war developers wanted to focus on. Like the Miami Beach hotel developers, the great steamship companies prided themselves not only on their new technology, offering guests, as we heard a little earlier, access to telephones, elevators, radios, air conditioning, chilled water, etc., and of course the latest in nautical engineering, but also an impressive array of interior furnishings and dramatic entertainment spaces, both public and private. What can historians of modern architecture make of these buildings and the large complexes of which they were a part? What do we even call these interiors, like the Fontainebleau lobby? These are questions that have consistently puzzled both scholars and architectural critics. While the design quality of Lapidus's work has been a subject of heated debate among architecture critics ever since the hotels first opened, there has never been any doubt about their popular success or the signal role played by the architect in creating a clear and memorable brand identity for high-end tourism in Miami Beach. Lapidus himself referred to his work as both modern and contemporary, and both terms seem to fit well, despite the fact that architects and critics alike deplored what we might today call the mashup of styles. In the lobby of the Fontainebleau, with its sleek and glamorous shapes, its emphasis on ornament and figuration, and its dramatic flair, tourists came just to look around and to sit on the comfortable furniture, and so many ashtrays were stolen that they had to be ordered by the gross. The well-known staircase to nowhere, a feature that Lapidus included at the Fontainebleau and at other hotels, really sums up the architect's skills and his goals as a designer. Less interested in making his mark amongst modernist architects and designers than in pleasing his high-paying clients, Lapidus recognized that many modern vacationers wanted to spend their time relaxing in a fantasy environment filled with real and fake antiques, shining lights, and plenty of opportunities to show off new clothes, new husbands, new wives, and girlfriends. The super graphic of the Roman Forum inserted here, which Lapidus would later claim was a bit of a joke, created exactly the sort of ambience that hotel visitors loved. In fact, the staircase to nowhere was part of a stage set. It simply provided access to the lobby from the mezzanine level above, where there was only a small card room and little else. The elevator only stopped at that level to give guests the opportunity to proceed down the curving staircase, observed by people in the lobby, like kings and queens, or glamorous models, or movie stars. Think of Gloria Swanson in Sunset Boulevard, right? The classic example. I mean, how many movies can we think of with staircases as an emblem of glamour? And Lapidus was a very, very smart architect. The staging and lighting and choreography were all part of an image ingrained in their, and I think our memories, one that they and we have known for years from going to the movies. This winning formula, curving staircases, old world luxury, beautiful clothes, modern conveniences, sleek modern ocean liner imagery, was to be repeated by Lapidus numerous times throughout the 50s and well into the 1960s, first at the Eden Rock, then later at the Hotel Americana, farther up Collins Avenue, a hotel that featured a large indoor terrarium complete with alligators and, of course, an enormous pool deck with glamorous palm trees and row after row of reclining pool loungers. Nevertheless, as we know, by the early 1960s, such lavish productions had begun to spell the end of mid-century modern design and the fantasy dream of American glamour and American exceptionalism. Now, bigger wasn't always better. Might didn't always make right. And as the civil rights movement would have it, if you weren't part of the solution, you were part of the problem. Often modern architecture came to be associated with an uncritical love of soulless technology, and mid-century modernism with its ties to big money and big government and individual progress and emancipation was often rejected along with the throwaway consumer of our parents and grandparents. These new ideas of the 1960s impacted not only American culture and American values, but also design thinking, first with the rise of postmodernism, of which Lapidus, you know, always in the game, claimed to have been a founding father, and then with movements like critical regionalism and late modernism, with their emphasis on local vernaculars, natural materials, and in the best projects, sustainability. In each of these new movements, as before, Jewish American architects and clients played an important role, creating a long line of talented practitioners and visionary developers that stretches from Dankmar Adler in the Chicago of the 1880s to Richard Neutra, Louis Kahn, Morris Lapidus in the 1950s and 60s, to Moshe Zafdi, Frank Gehry, and Richard Meyer today, to name only a few. We would be hard-pressed to find a common theme in the work of these architects, and nor would we want to, I think. But we should note, nevertheless, the defining role played by Jewish men and women in making architecture modern, not only in the past, but in the present moment as well. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Alice, for that glamorous talk. Indeed, I just have to say that just the mention and seeing the Fountain Blue brings back memories of my childhood in Miami Beach and what represented definitely the core of the American dream for we from studies, offered jointly by Parsons the New School and Cooper Hewitt Smithsonian Design Museum. You've now seen the film about Ruth, so I don't feel I need to give you too much of a bio for her, because it's all there. But I don't recall whether in the film they told you that in 2015 she was awarded the prestigious Kresge Prize. So I'm now going to turn this over to Sarah and Ruth.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Can everybody hear me? Wonderful. Ruth, are you all set?
Can you hear me?
Great. I first want to say that that film, that 15-minute excerpt, is part of a larger one-hour documentary on the life of Ruth, and it's terrific. You can buy it online or get it out of your local library, and I really encourage all of you to watch the full version. It's a terrific documentary. So, Ruth, why don't we start? Let me start my, can we start our PowerPoint, please? And while they're getting that set up, why don't we start to talk a little bit about your early life in Germany? You come from a very old Frankfurt family, a very cultured family. As the film mentioned, your mother, Marie Adler, attended the Bauhaus. She was friends with Tilly Wertheim, the sister of Eric Mendelssohn, the great modernist architect. Your family was instrumental in bringing the clays to Dusseldorf. What was it like to grow up in that kind of environment?
Difficult. In one word, difficult.
Difficult.
Because my parents were very strict and were very much interested in our intellectual activities. Actually, the Adler family, Adler means eagle. Adler is an eagle in German. It reaches back to 1500 in the city of Frankfurt, and is actually the eagle is part of the heraldic symbol of the city of Frankfurt. But Frankfurt, if you visited there, is a very old city, and my mother, who was always very strong in her opinions, insisted that the family move to Düsseldorf. Düsseldorf, on the other hand, is extremely modern, filled with museums and contemporary buildings, and just a wonderful place to bring up children. Except in 1933, of course, when I was 10 years old, the Nazis marched into, Hitler took over the Reichstag, and the Nazis marched into Düsseldorf.
Can you tell us a little bit about what happened in 1938 on Kristallnacht and part of your escape out of Germany?
From 33 to 38, it was very difficult to not only go to school as a Jewish child. We were delegated to the last row in the classroom. And I remember having been whipped when I didn't know a math problem. I'm very poor in mathematics. The teacher took a belt and just hit me. And eventually, we were no longer, after 1936, we were no longer allowed to attend school. My parents sent me to Switzerland to learn French and to go to school there.
How did you like school in Switzerland?
I didn't. I was very homesick. And for that reason, I think I just didn't learn French very well. But things became so difficult in Germany that my mother insisted we should leave. My dad would not hear of it. As I just said, the family went back so many hundreds of years in Germany. And he always said, a country that brings Schiller and Goethe and Lessing and Beethoven into the world cannot do but be artistic and intellectually stimulating. Well, as you all know, it turned out quite differently. And in 1938, they came to our house and totally destroyed everything, everything. And my dad was taken into what they called protective custody, into the concentration camp in Dachau. And my entire, except for my brother and my parents, my entire family was gassed and perished.
How did your mother manage to bring your father back?
That's the great wonder. My parents had connections in Holland and Belgium, and she threatened the German authority with the fact that she would get in touch with those people and tell them what was happening. Because even when we came to this country in 1939, no one had heard of concentration camps. It wasn't until Eisenhower liberated the camps in 1945 after the war that that people in this country understood what was happening. The Germans were very secretive about it. And I don't think many people even realized what Kristallnacht was about when they came to totally demolish everything.
And your mother was an extremely foresighted person, and she managed to bring your belongings, your papers, some of those photographs that we saw in the film, so you've managed to save a lot of things.
Well, it was difficult. Of course, our entire house was destroyed. And my mother was able to find relatives in this country. Perhaps you remember Roosevelt had set a quota for immigrants. She managed to find someone who would be able to get us out of Germany. And she also managed to get every piece of furniture repaired at a very high cost. And then you had to have it appraised by the German government and then pay the appraised price to the government. Mm-hmm. And this made their war chest, actually.
So thank God your family managed to escape.
Yes.
And you came over a very rough passage overseas through France off to Detroit.
Right.
And as the film said, you won a scholarship to RISD. And can you describe a little bit about how you came to be a designer, and a textile designer in particular?
I didn't set out to be a textile designer. My dream was to be an architect. But the Rhode Island School of Design had a very limited architectural department. And when I won the Prix de Paris, the winners were usually sent to Europe. However, it was right after the war, and so they got people positions in their career, in their field. They found a job for me at Lord & Taylor's.
And how did you like working in a department
store? I didn't, because Lord & Taylor's in those days had a very fine antique furniture department, and they thought that would be my calling. And I lasted 2 days, and I went back to them, and I said, I'm really not that interested in antique furniture. I like contemporary styles. And this is how I got to Raymond Loewy. I was thrilled. Raymond Loewy was the industrial designer, the first industrial designer, I think. And as you saw in the film, I became the assistant to the architectural designer and worked with Yamazaki and Warren Plattner.
And when you were at Loewy and Associate, you worked there for some time, and then you left to go to Cranbrook, promising to return. Is that right?
Yes. He promised me that job back. Well, I had won a fellowship to Cranbrook, I did not want to leave New York. It was so wonderful to be here. And Cranbrook, if you're familiar with the Detroit area, is way out in the country. I just couldn't see myself being out in the country after all the wonderful the museums and the music and Shakespeare in the Park and all the wonderful things that had happened to me here in New York. I did not want to go. My dad sent a one-way ticket from New York to Detroit, and this is how I ended up at Cranbrook. It was very difficult at Cranbrook.
How so? I saw that you studied ceramics with Maya Gertel. How was that experience at Cranbrook for you?
In those days, architecture offices were not hiring women, especially not Jewish women. And so I thought I would find a job in industrial design, which sure. I thought was the closest to it. But that also didn't happen. However, I found wonderful friends at Cranbrook. Eliel Saarinen was very supportive. And
the director of Cranbrook.
He was the head of the architectural department, and perhaps you all know Eliel's work, the St. Louis Arc. And
his son, Eero. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Anyway, they felt that in order for a woman to get a position in an architectural office, you had to compete, you had to submit your work to competitions, and make sure it's good. And once, and even if you get honorable mention, Eliel always said, it will be publicized and you will find a position in the field.
That's good advice.
Well, I submitted my work to the Chicago Tribune, and they had a competition to design a house that would hold all the new gadgets that had been worked on or designed during the war and were now coming on the market. And when I, and it was of course a steel and glass house, but I couldn't find fabrics for it. Everything was French provincial, and cabbage roses did not fit into such an interior. So I designed my own fabrics, and they turned out to be very bold, very large, abstract shapes in incredibly bright colors. That was brand new at the time.
Well, so why don't I put on some visuals as we're talking here? Absolutely. So you win honorable mention in this competition, and then you design the textiles for the automotive windows, the showrooms that have these huge plate glass windows that need these coverings.
Shades and vertical blinds hadn't been invented,
right.
And they felt that draperies would soften the glare of the sun because they didn't want the lacquer of the new cars faded.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So this is how your textile...
That's how I fell into it.
But you know, what's interesting is I think many people, of course, know your textiles. What might not be as well known is your shop that you ran with your husband, Anishne. And I was wondering, let's skip around a little bit here. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about your work and your collaboration with your husband and what Adler Schnee was and how you really were a promoter of modern design at mid-century, certainly in the Midwest and beyond.
How can I explain that? I just fell in love. And although Eddie did not have a design background, but he was a graduate of Yale University, he was very bright, and he was very adept at managing the financial end of our marriage.
That's important.
Yeah. The fabrics absolutely did not sell. Nobody wanted contemporary designs. Nobody wanted bright colors. Everything was in beiges and grays, and that was not what I was producing. We really fell into having a shop also by accident, because we displayed beautiful pottery in our studio, in our print shop, and people had never seen that. The pottery that was shown by the previous speaker, the Russell Wright ware, and Edith Heath's pottery. Sure. And so that was really the beginning of our retail store.
And you also sold modern furniture, yes. Scandinavian and yeah. Charles and Ray Eames. And yeah. You met Charles and Ray Eames.
Oh, yes. Well, Charlie Eames had been at Cranbrook a year before I arrived. And so did Florence Schust, who married Hans Knoll. So there was a group of people that were producing good contemporary furniture, and we carried that in our shop because we knew those people.
Sure. Did people buy it at the time?
I beg your
pardon? Did they buy the furniture,
no.
Or did it sell like the textiles?
It was extremely difficult. As a matter of fact, we didn't have the money to buy the catalog of Alvar Aalto's furniture, the Arctic Pasco. And so I drew the Pasco furniture on the walls of our shop and showed people the wood finishes. And to my amazement, there were some that bought, mm-hmm. that, trusted us enough. I think they had never really seen it mm-hmm. in Michigan. And this is how our store developed.
And then was quite successful over time. It had several different locations. You moved yeah. out of the small garage and into the better addresses down in
yes,
Detroit.
And the major department store in Detroit is Hudson's, J.L. Hudson Company. And they turned over their appliance repair space to us. And my husband did not like malls. He felt they were very plastic. Mm-hmm. But to be in the downtown area where we could promote Detroit, and that is really what he wanted. And he was a wonderful educator because he spent most of his time telling people how wonderful contemporary design is and why dishes should be white and not with flower designs, so that the food shows up, and why we carried stainless steel in certain shapes because people eat differently in mm-hmm. Europe. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that was really Eddie's wonderful contribution.
I was wondering if we could talk a little bit about some of your textiles. If you want to take a look, we have all different. These are from the early 50s. This one is entitled Construction, Wireworks, Country Fair, and Strings and Things. And I'm wondering, is there any particular fabric you might want to talk about a little bit? And
well, construction is obvious, my architectural. those scaffolds and ladders is what inspired that. Wireworks is an unusual design because I had a roommate at the Rhode Island School of Design who came from Boston. And Alexander Calder had a workshop in Boston. And was a friend of their family. And I had the great privilege of having access to Calder's workshop. And I remember he was working at the time on fireplace tools. Perhaps some of you have seen it. The Whitney Museum yes. has a whole collection of it. And he was working, bending wires into tools, and that inspired Wireworks. Now the next one is Country Fair, and we spent a lot of time in Mexico working with the Mexican Indians, on bringing their crafts into our shop. Mm-hmm. And that is really a Mexican bazaar that's inspired that one. And then the last one.
Strings
and Things. That goes back to my work with Raymond Loewy. Raymond Loewy, as I'm sure you all know, was the designer of the Studebaker car and the Pennsylvania Railroad. And in that office, I was introduced to streamlining. Of course, because we were working with fast traffic and streamlining was at the time condoned by the Museum of Modern Art. They felt it was not serving a decorative purpose. However, I was totally enchanted by it. And the first design that you saw with my picture behind it was narrow gauge. And that was inspired by railroad tracks and fast locomotive moving across it, and Strings and Things is also really a traffic pattern, little cars moving fast on highways, mm-hmm. and that's what inspired that. So it's really the world around us that inspires designers. I feel very strongly about that.
You know, you mentioned in the film, and I think we're in the context of a Jewish symposium today, but I think equally notable is that you're a woman working in a design field early on in the post-war. And I was wondering, how did you navigate this, having three children and a shop and a household and a partner?
With difficulty. As I mentioned in the film, I always stayed home to be with the kids until lunchtime, and then when they were young, I put them for their afternoon nap, and that's when I then went to our shop and our studio and worked, and then all night after we put the kids to bed. That's why I admire women who have careers and have families. You have to have a supportive husband. I think that's the secret of it.
For sure, and he said to you, right, he didn't marry you for your cooking.
No, I told him when we were first engaged, I said, I'm not a housefrau. I hate cooking. I can't clean. I don't do laundry. So I had a good helper.
That's fantastic. Why don't we speak a little bit about, in some of our remaining time, in some of the designs you're working on today. You know, Ruth has been continually designing for over 50 years, and in 2012, Noel signed Ruth to a 20-year exclusive contract for textiles. This is true. And in fact, actually, you had been offered a career or a contract with Noel many years before.
In 1947.
Can you tell us about that story?
Well, I designed for the airline industry. In those days, tourist and first class were divided by a screen. Now they have a drapery that they pull across. And I had a design, Fancy Free, that we printed on a very gossamer sheer batiste, which is a very fine cotton. And the airline industry had it between two sheets of clear plexiglass. Well, Hans Noll, who, as I'm sure you know, was the owner and founder of the Noll Furniture Company, saw the design and came from New York to Detroit to get that design. Well, I didn't realize at that time that people could pay me for my design. And so my dad had his attorney there, and Noel said, well, we don't pay for the designs. And my dad said, we are not going to give Ruth designs away without being reimbursed for it. So when the Knoll people, many years, like 2 years ago, called me and said, we're interested in that, in a 20-year contract, I said, I was already in my 90s. I said to them, do you realize how old I am? And they said, it doesn't matter. And it's been a very wonderful relationship. And when I told them that story, he said, well, you know, we still aren't paying for this. So anyway, that's...
So you're designing new textiles, and they're also reissuing some of your earlier work. I see we have fission chips here on the bottom. We have strata, originally from 1948, on the top. So how are these changing, or how are you working with Noel and also Anzia? This is called Rock Candy from 2007 and Pogo Stick from 2014.
Well, Noel had an incredible idea. As a matter of fact, I have a meeting with him tomorrow. Healthcare is the big thing in the industry these days, and they wanted draperies for the hospitals because everything is so drab in the hospitals. And the two designs on the left are what they call privacy curtains. They're woven, the design is woven into a textile, a very sheer textile that they use, that the hospitals use for encircling a bed when a patient gets examined and needs privacy. And that's usually been plastic curtains mm-hmm. or very drab colors. Now, then we're working on, and that's what we're doing tomorrow, prints on polyurethane. Now, polyurethane is an upholstery vinyl, and it's usually in solid colors. And no, and maybe I shouldn't even talk about it.
We won't tell anyone.
To use it as a printed material is brand new and requires a whole different technology. Mm-hmm. So it's wonderful.
And as Marilyn mentioned, just as a final point to talk about, just I think 2 or 3 weeks ago, you were awarded the Kresge. You went to the big benefit, the Kresge Award. And there's going to be another book written about you as well, and you're in all of these exhibitions. What do you make of this now? Charles Eames had said, good design will sell eventually, but did you think it would take this long?
It took 50 years. And I still think it's not in the popular mind yet, I think. But I'm extremely grateful that it's finally recognized. And anyway, what can I tell you? I had no idea how important the Kresge Foundation is, especially in Michigan, because as you all know, Detroit was in bankruptcy and Kresge channeled funds to reestablish the city and get it back on track. And funds for artists and the cultural activities in Detroit. It's really a marvelous foundation. Yes. I think it's billions of dollars.
Well, you're a very worthy recipient.
Yes, wonderful. So I'm very grateful. The only problem is it keeps me from my work.
This is true. You know, every time Ruth and I try to coordinate for the symposium, we would make appointments and it would say, you know, call me, you know, 4 days from now at 3 o'clock because I'm teaching, I'm working, I'm in my studio, the film crew is here today, I'm being interviewed, so it's, I don't know how you do this all and still continue to design.
I'm very grateful.
Well, we're very grateful that you were here for us today.
Thank you.
And thank you for talking with me.
Okay.
Wonderful. So you stay right where you are, and I think Marilyn is going to reconvene all of the speakers for some question and answer.
Yes.
Okay.
I want to thank Ruth and Sarah for this wonderful and so engaging opportunity to hear Ruth talk about an amazing and inspiring career as a Jewish woman designer in mid-century America, still practicing up until today, and so actively involved in design. And her textiles are still available through the manufacturer, Anzia, right?
That's right. Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to ask Jenna and Alice, please, to return to the stage to answer questions along with Ruth and Sarah in our remaining time here.
Alice is going to get a microphone, I think.
Okay.
Here she comes. Okay.
Questions, anyone? Okay. Hold on.
May I call you Ruth?
Yes.
I've been staring at your beautiful outfit and was wondering if that was one of your designs.
Yes.
Wow.
It's crocheted. And I crocheted it.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, it was Alice. I was just in thinking of your talk and having actually given away my age, remember going to Miami Beach when I was 4 years old in the 50s when the building was relatively new, the Fontainebleau. I mean, I remember it vividly. But, you know, I remember most people stayed in the smaller deco buildings. And I have pictures of my mother in Miami Beach in the early 40s in the deco buildings. And, you know, I was thinking of glamour and Hollywood and the earlier everything coming out of deco. And I just wonder if you could talk about that. I mean, certainly Lapidus is much more bigger and a different kind of modernism, but there's certainly in some of the threads, you know, the acceptance of modernism coming out of deco.
No, you're absolutely right. And it's, I think across the boards, the 20s, the 30s are very strongly influential in the design, obviously, of the 40s and 50s and into the 60s. And I, as a historian, I'm sure, you know, we could all think about this. The way your tastes are shaped are by the decades in which you were small and a teenager, and then you come into a certain role as a designer or consumer, let's say in the 50s, and your culture is the culture that you're bringing with you from the 20s and 30s. And I think that's true across the boards. When we think about the lighting, the ornamentation, theatricality, many of those aspects. Now, when it comes to the small hotels of Miami Beach, it's a more complicated picture because, for example, the demographic who used or patronized those hotels in the 30s and 40s was of much more modest means. And the rooms were small. They tended to have big closets because people came for a long time. But even today, if you book into one of those hotels, the rooms are small. And so, for example, Morris, when I raised exactly this question in my interviews with him a gazillion years ago, right around 2000, and asked about that relationship and also to his support for the Deco District, South Beach. He said, absolutely not. I hate those hotels. I stayed there when I was poor, and I have no interest. My hotels were for a completely different kind of person. So there's the socioeconomic piece, but I think from a point of view of design sensibility, the ocean liner, the sense of ornamentation, the theatricality, many, many aspects from the 20s. And you know, Lapidus was a hugely influenced by Mendelssohn in his lighting and his department store designs. Perhaps others could comment on that, but and we know those buildings, someone like me knows them through photography, right? Night photography in particular, and also the typography, which you see in the Deco hotels and the marquees, masts, et cetera. I think those are all very influential on the 50s, particularly someone like Lapidus, but others as well. So thank you for that question.
Any other questions?
This is a question for Ruth. I'm just curious to hear a little bit more about your family's relationship with Paul Klee.
What?
The relationship with Klee. Paul Klee.
It's mentioned in the film early on that your family had a relationship with Paul Klee, and I'm curious to hear a little bit more about that and that influence on you.
My mother was a student of the Bauhaus and met the Klees there, the Weimar Bauhaus. As you all know, Klee eventually came to Düsseldorf. My dad was a financial advisor and into real estate, and the Klees had asked him to find a house for them in Düsseldorf. And luckily, the house was just a few doors down from where we lived. So the Klees, first of all, I should say, Frau Klee was a fantastic cook, and I loved her cooking. And so my brother and I spent a lot of time in their house, and he let us play in his studio. He had mobiles and starbills and wonderful colors in that studio, and it's just something that I will never forget. And then when I went to Switzerland to school, I visited them in Bern at the time. And again, they were very gracious and the cooking was wonderful. So that's about as much as I can tell you about the Klees. But I do think it influences you when you have that kind of surrounding as a child.
Okay.
This question is for Ms. Adler Schnee. I was curious about your textiles. You always screen printed them? Is that your most textile design was done in your screen printing?
Were your textiles screen printed?
Oh, yes, we silk screen printed it. There is a picture in the film with my husband holding up a screen. Silk screen printing had really never been done on fabric. It was always, of course, on paper. Most posters were printed by silk screen. And those of you who are not familiar with the process, it's a wooden frame that is stretched originally with silk, but in those days, right after the war, you couldn't get silk. And so we stretched it with organdy, which is also a very fine cotton fiber. And then the design is cut in on a film, and the film is adhered to the screen, and the openings of the design is where the ink goes through the fabric and drops onto the cloth. And that's really how the printing process is done. You have to be very careful that you don't smudge as you go along with the screen. You don't smudge one pattern and then the next repeat smudges the other, so it's alternating. And then you have to come back and do the in-between pattern. So it's quite, and then of course it needs to be hung up and dried. And we had a cleaner in Detroit who liked my work, who then ran it through his steaming machine, and that set the color. So for many years, we were worried that the color would fade, but it never did. The fabrics that are now at the various museums are as brilliant as the day we printed them. And that's, so, I think, to my great joy.
Could I ask another question? I was wondering, when you were at Cranbrook, did you ever work with Marion Strangle? Did you ever work with Marion Strangle at Cranbrook?
Did I work with whom?
In the weaving.
No, I didn't. I wasn't part of the textile. Marion Strangle was the head of the textile department after Loya Saarinen resigned. I was never part of the textile department because I was in the architectural department, where the Saarinens, Eliel and Eero, taught. So I had no connection with Marianne. Of course, I'm familiar with her work. So.
Yep.
I have a hard time hearing people.
It distorts. The microphone distorts. This.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not yet out of here.
No. I am.
Yeah, this is a question for Ruth also. I wonder if you could talk about the Wiener Werk.
Is that for you?
I don't know for you, but I couldn't hear it either.
If you were influenced by the Wiener Werkstätte at all. The Wiener Werkstätte, if we were influenced by that at all.
By whom?
The Wiener Werkstätte.
That's very interesting. Of course, I'm familiar with the Wiener Werkstätte, and my mother knew Hoffmann. And I had some of the designs in my house. I love them, and they can still be specified. We have a firm in Detroit that imports some of the original furnishings through Whitman. So, yes, I'm very familiar with that. I've specified it myself.